much. Sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down. Not necessary. I am so proud of you. I am so proud of this church, of who we are, of the place that we hold in this community and that we will continue to build upon. That is our word for the day, right? To build. And that is what we are doing. And so thank you. Thank you to everyone who helped make Wednesday happen. It was an incredible evening. So thank you. Thank you. Welcome to worship, everyone. I extend grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, and we welcome you to this place, whether you are here in the sanctuary or joining us online. Welcome. You are welcome here. I hope for those of you that are here, if you notice in the pew back in front of you, there is a connection card there. That's our best way to get to know you a little bit more, whether you're new with us or have had a change in information. Simply fill that card out and put it in the offering plate later in worship. If you're joining us online, we hope that you will take notes in the comments section and let us know that you are joining us as well. Now it is July 4th weekend, and as we give thanks for our country and celebrate our nation, I invite you to stand as we sing God Bless America. And greet those around you.
They adore him, which makes us happy. It's a mutual admiration. puppy, so she's kind of bullheaded. Leo, so both of them have their own very unique personalities. That's exciting.
As you find your way back to your seats, I invite you to take a look at your bulletin this morning with all the events and activities coming up in the life of the church. Again, a big thank you to everyone who helped to support for the time of prayer and action that took place this last Wednesday. One of the calls to action from that event was a pledge to participate in an act of kindness. And so if you were not here and or weren't able to participate in that pledge, I'm going to ask Christina to pop that up. Perfect. So it's a QR code. So if you have your phone available, you just pull out your camera, open up your camera on your phone, and when you place it over that QR code, just like you do with a menu in a restaurant, place it over the QR code, a little link will pop up, and it'll take you to a form, and that is a commitment to participate in an act of kindness in response to the events in our community. There you'll also find information about a community-wide Shabbat service that is being planned for August. And so as that gets closer, I'll have more information to share with you. I hope that we can participate in that. But I hope you will commit to spreading light through this pledge. One of the other things that we offered this past Wednesday was an opportunity for folks to write cards to our neighbors over at Chabad of Cobb, where the presentation, anti-Semitic presentation took place. There are still note cards available in the gathering place. I did not take them. I was planning to take them last Thursday, but I thought, no, I want to give our congregation one last chance to write any notes of support and encouragement to the Chabad of Cobb. So out in the gathering place, there are note cards there with pens. Simply fill out a note of encouragement and support, pop it in the basket, and those will be delivered to Rabbi Silverman and the good folks over at Chabad of Cobb this week. I do hope that you have on your calendar as well camp meeting that's coming up in 2 Sundays, as well as our Rise Against Hunger meal packing event that's coming up on July 23rd. It may be summertime, folks may be here, there, and yonder, but the work of the church does not stop. We continue to be the hands and feet of Christ in so many ways, and I am grateful to all of you for that. So let's celebrate, shall we? Let's celebrate who we are as the church through song. Will you stand and let's sing?
Oh,
Amen. You may be seated. And at this time, I'd like to invite the children to come join me up front. Hi, guys. Oh, sliding into home. You're safe. Come on up, guys. All right. Well, good morning, everybody. Hi, it's good to see you. I am Pastor Kristen, and I am so glad that you are here with me today. All right, I am going to need your help this morning. All right, Brandon, do you think you can help me? Yeah, I think everybody can help me. So today we are talking about building. And so I brought some building blocks today. But there's something very special about what we are going to build this morning, all right? We are going to build the way that the Bible tells us to build. And in the Bible, they tell us that Jesus goes first, that Jesus is what's called the foundation. The foundation, all of your houses that you live in, they have a foundation. It's the very bottom that holds your house all together. All right? And so the Bible tells us that Jesus has to be right at the bottom that holds everything together. So this red block is going to be our Jesus block. So it's going to go first. And we are going to build on top of it. Okay? So when we are building, we add things to it, right? Right? And when we're building in our lives, hey, Fowler, come on up, my dear. All right, I won't look at you. All right, so when we are building, we add different things, right? If we have Jesus in our life, we add other things too, right? We might add our family. Brandon, would you come put this block on next? Can you add our family block on top? Perfect, awesome. All right, let's see. Then we might have our friends. Benjamin, you wanna come add this one? Can you put this one on top? Very nice. All right. And then we might have our school. Do you want to come right at our school? Where do you think that one might go? Awesome. All right. And then we have our fun, right? We have our fun. You want to add our fun block? It's green. I like the green block. Fun and games. Yeah. All right. And then Xander, we have everything else, right? There's so much in our life that gets added to. You want to add that one? You can put it wherever you want. There we go. All right, that's pretty good building, I think. I like that a lot. You like it too? I like it too. All right, do you want to help me or do you want to sit there? You want to sit there? Okay, all right. So this is how the Bible tells us to build, with Jesus at the foundation. Now, what do you think would happen if we took Jesus away from our lives? Should we try it? You think so?
Yeah,
all right, I'm going to take Jesus out. Ah, you were right.
Everything fell down.
If we take Jesus out, right, everything falls apart, right? So we have to remember to always keep Jesus in everything we do, right? Whether it's our family or our friends, or our school, or our fun, and everything else. Keep Jesus in it all. All right, can you guys put your hands together? Put your hands together? All right, will you repeat after me? Dear God, thank you for giving us your son, Jesus. Help us to keep Jesus in all we do. We love you. Amen. Awesome. Thank you guys so much. All right, you can head out to Children's Church. Thank you. What?
My squishy said the prayer.
Oh, my goodness. Your squishy said the prayer.
Good morning. I'm Pat Holcomb, lay leader here. And I've had cold chills all morning as we've been practicing the patriotic songs for today, and it just makes me so proud to be an American and so proud to be a member of this church. Amen? Yes. Yes. So now it's the time in our service for prayer. The altar is open. Please come and kneel at the altar as you want to, or pray in your seats. Pray with me now. Father God, we thank you for this day and for the opportunity and the freedom to gather here in this place in your name and to worship you through prayer, music, and word. Please continue to be with our Jewish friends who experienced so much hatred last weekend. Rabbi Dorsch shared at the community prayer service that we had that the Jewish synagogues must spend most of their resources on security that instead could be used to help others in their communities. They experience hate and fear that we, as Christians here in the United States, don't. So their freedom to worship you, Lord, must be protected. We don't understand the fear that they must experience just to be in their place of worship. So help us, Lord, to always be kind and to spread kindness and light to all that we encounter. There is no greater feeling of liberty than to experience freedom from sin and death that you provided for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Today, our hearts and souls are free to praise you, and for this, we are very thankful. On Independence Day, we're reminded of all those who have sacrificed for our freedom, following the example of Jesus Christ, who sacrificed his life so that we can live our life eternally with you, God. Let us never to take our freedom for granted, both physical and spiritual. And may we always remember that a very high price was paid for our freedom. And our freedom costs others their very life. Father, bless those who have served and continue to serve to give their lives for the freedom that we have in this country. Meet their needs and watch over their families. We're so thankful for this nation, for all the sacrifices others have made to build and defend this country. We are forever grateful. Thank you for the opportunities and freedoms that we have in the United States of America, and help us to never take those blessings for granted. Help us, Lord, to live our life in a way that glorifies you. Give us the strength to be a blessing in someone's life today, and grant us the opportunity to lead others into the freedom that can be found in knowing Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pat. As we come to our time of offering, you know, we like to celebrate how your gifts are being used in our community. We've talked about the service this past Wednesday, and we celebrated last week the blankets that were up on the altar rail, as well as the bags and bags of food that were packed for the summer lunch program. And so we want to offer those who may not have an opportunity to have seen those a little glimpse into the mission projects from this past month. So Christina, if you'll play the video.
Bring what you have to his table, even though you have little to give. And God will use your hands to feed the multitudes. He says, bring what you have to his table. He says, bring what you have to his table. Bring it here to him. Bring what you have to his table, even though you have little to give. And God will use your hands to feed the multitudes. He says, bring what you have to his table. He says, bring what you have to his table. Bring it here to him. A little boy had five loaves, couldn't be more than he give.
So thank you for your support, for your time, your gifts, and your energy for 55 blankets for Ukraine and 132 lunches prepared for Must Ministries. It's incredible, the work that is done here, and I am grateful. And as it said, we'll see you in July for Rise Against Hunger, where we will pack 10,000 meals. So this was just a little teaser, right, for July. But as our ushers come forward, we receive this morning, offering to God our gifts, offering our tithes, and may we all truly offer our very lives to God.
We are a nation under God, founded on the principle of truth. That all of us are equal, born with a sovereign right to live within our laws the way we should. Dreams.
You may be seated. Well, this summer, we have been talking about the movements of the Holy Spirit, this third person of the Trinity who is constantly at work in our lives and in our world, but one whose movements we sometimes struggle to name. So we've been using Jack Leveson's book, 40 Days with the Holy Spirit, to give us some language on the Holy Spirit's movements, some of these action words, these verbs that describe how the Holy Spirit is at work. We've talked about breathing, praying, practicing, learning. Today, we turn, as we have said, to building, how the Holy Spirit moves us to build together, to build as one. Our scripture for today comes from 1 Corinthians, Paul's letter to the church in Corinth. And I remind you of the setting of this letter, that as Paul reaches out to the people in Corinth, he is addressing their issues. The early church had issues, right? I sometimes take comfort in that we are not the only ones that have issues. The early church had issues, and in fact, they had issues of splintering and splitting. That some were following after one leader, some following after another, and little branches started to form, breaking off. Some Paul, some Peter, some Apollos. And so Paul writes to them to try and bring them back together, unite them under the one Spirit. And so we read from the third chapter of 1 Corinthians. I'll read the 10th and 11th verses, and then we're going to jump a little bit to verse 16, but you'll see it on the screens. I laid a foundation, like a wise master builder, according to God's grace that was given to me. But someone else is building on top of it. Each person needs to pay attention to the way they build on it. No one can lay any other foundation besides the one that is already laid, which is Jesus Christ. Don't you know that you are God's temple and God's Spirit lives in you? If someone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person, because God's temple is holy, which is what you are. Don't fool yourself. If some of you think they are worldly wise, then they should become foolish so that they can become wise. This world's wisdom is foolishness to God. As it is written, he catches the wise in their cleverness. And also, the Lord knows that the thoughts of the wise are silly. So then, no one should brag about human beings. Everything belongs to you. Paul, Apollos, Cephas, the world, life, death, things in the present, things in the future. Everything belongs to you. But you belong to Christ, and Christ belongs to God. Friends, this is the word of God for us, the people of God, and we say, thanks be to God. You can almost hear it, right? Knowing the setting, where the people are as they listen to Paul's words. We're over here, and they're over there, and they're way over there. And Paul says, you're being crazy. Come back together. Because each and every one of you is God's. And that should be at the core of this new church, this new kind of faith community you seek to build. In his book, Jack Leveson writes that verse 16, that one that says, don't you know you are God's temple? It really needs to be translated into Southern. Because Paul is using the plural you. And we are real good here in the South with the plural you, are we not? Verse 16, don't y'all know that y'all are God's temple? And God's Spirit lives in y'all. It's straight from Paul's hand to my lips, right? Don't y'all know? We know the temptation to live into this kind of individual faith where it's all about me, and as long as I'm right with God, then that's all right in the world. But we cannot forget that we are all in this together. You and you and you and you, all y'all. Y'all are God's temple. God's Spirit lives in y'all, so be as one. Come together. Build a community together. Because at the foundation, at the core of who all y'all are, is Jesus. Everything else is built upon that, just like we did with the children. Everything else is built upon that, but that remains solid and true. And that remains the same for all of us, for all y'all. Can we agree upon that at least? Can we come together with that one uniting factor under the Spirit to build something together? If you were hesitant to answer, yes, we can do that before, I hope that Wednesday proved that yes, we can. That as we had standing room only in the sanctuary, as we had folks gathered in the narthex, Christians, Jews, Muslims together, he said, we have a foundation in God. And we as Christians, we name that movement of the Holy Spirit at work within us and around us together, uniting us for something good and true. Now, some of you, especially the staff, are aware that this Sunday is probably the hardest Sunday for me of the whole year, the Sunday around July 4th. I struggle tremendously as a faith leader on the national holiday, because I feel the tension that exists. Am I proud to be an American? Yes, Lee Greenwood, I am. Ruthie Jean painted my nails. I don't know if you can see. On Friday, we had a little manicure party at home. I am grateful to live in this country. But it's hard for me, too, when I see that tension that exists between who we are as citizens of a nation and citizens of a kingdom. We can be both. Yes, we can be both. We are both. But when our citizenship in our nation starts to take priority over our citizenship in a kingdom, when it starts to rub me the wrong way. And so I struggle. I struggle with how much of July 4th to include in a worship service. But I also recognize that we are gathering here as a community under one Spirit. And so we can celebrate who we are as Americans. We can celebrate who we are as a nation, as one of those building blocks on top of our foundation, maintaining this solid core of who we are and allowing it to permeate through how we live how we live as Americans. I'm grateful, Pat, for your words in the prayer that we recognize that we have this great freedom in our country to worship as we please, but recognize that it is experienced differently by our neighbors. And I'm grateful that we are taking our core of who we are as Christians, applying that freedom we have as Americans, and fighting for our neighbors to say they have just as much right to worship freely as we do. And that our calling under the Spirit of God calls us to love our neighbor no matter what. And that is how we build together. To build, yes, build a better nation. But even more so, to build up God's kingdom. That together we will build on the footprint of Jesus. And that with each layer we build, we ask ourselves, are we still reflecting that footprint? Do we still see Jesus in all that we do and in all that we are? And as we do, as we build this kind of community, as we build this kind of nation, as we build this kind of kingdom, those on the outside, as Paul says, will see it as folly. It will be wild and crazy. How can you and you sit together in a pew? Are you kidding me? And we just have to laugh and say, well, we may not agree on everything. We may not agree on anything, except that foundation that is the same, that footprint of Jesus that we are building on together. Building a community like that, building something with Christ at the foundation through the power of the Holy Spirit, it will look crazy. But I believe God will call it beautiful. As I was sharing about my sermon this morning with my husband, he said, would you mind if I sent you an article that I read? And I said, oh, sure, okay. He said, I think it would apply. And I'm grateful that he did. It was an article about a cathedral being built in Spain. I know we have some folks that have been to Spain recently. I'm sure many of you visited the Sagrada Familia. But how many of you visited Mejorada del Campo? No? No? How many of you have even heard of Mejorada del Campo? It is a town outside Madrid, and there lived a former monk named Justo Gallego Martinez. When Martinez was young, he was very poor with his mother, and she taught him, raised him in the scriptures. And as he went off into the world, he says that he went looking for someone as beautiful as the Virgin Mary. And when he could not find a woman as beautiful as the Virgin Mary, he decided to commit his life to God. He became a monk at an early age. But then he contracted tuberculosis. And at that time, when he returned to the monastery, they would not let him back in. So he had to find his own path, his own way to serve God. And in 1961, he determined that the way he would serve God was to build a cathedral for God. And he went to work every day for 60 years building a cathedral as an offering to God. This cathedral, as I said, now sits in Mejorada del Campo outside Madrid. It is actually almost the size of the Sagrada Familia, but it is made completely from donated items, discarded items, recycled items. Christina, will you pop up the picture of Justo's Cathedral? One man, 60 years of work for this cathedral. I invite you, as you have time later today or this week, to Google it, Justo Gallego Martinez, and look at some of the other pictures of the inside and around it. It's incredible. Now it is, or was up until 2 years ago, an illegal cathedral. He did not ask for any permits, he did not ask for any permission, he just went about building. Justo, as you can imagine, was the kind of man that was always a little different. He didn't fit in. He once told a Spanish television station, "It's easy to overcome people's judgment. They call me crazy. So what? I'll get over it." But Justo wasn't crazy, as one reporter writes. He was just unwilling to submit to what most people considered normal. He didn't need love or approbation because he had purpose. And that was enough. As he continued to build and the structure grew and grew and grew, he went from madman to genius. They actually held an exhibit in the Museum of Modern Art, MoMA, of pictures of his cathedral. They invited him to go, and he said, "No, I'm too busy. I got too much to do." The cathedral was then featured in a television ad for Coca-Cola in Spain. He said he ended up regretting doing that. All he saw when they came and asked him was how many more bricks he could buy with the money. But he felt like they turned his offering to God into just another commercialization project. Justo died in 2021. He's buried in the crypt of his cathedral as he built and planned. And it is now owned and operated by Mensajeros de la Paz, or Messengers of Peace, which is a Catholic NGO that serves the poor in over 50 countries. Padre Angel, who is the head of Mensajeros de la Paz, he himself was once deemed a bit of a crazy man when he envisioned his movement to serve the poor. But Messengers of Peace is now one of the biggest Catholic NGOs in the world. As one reporter who visited Justo over and over throughout the years wrote, "Justo told me that he had long been content with his efforts, even though the cathedral was unfinished. He didn't believe in perfection. How could he? Perfection was God, unattainable. Perfection was really only the mask of ambition, and Justo wasn't driven by ambition. His cathedral was full of half-baked ideas, trial and error, and moments of brilliance." I think that's what building a community guided by the Spirit can often feel like. Half-baked ideas, a lot of trial and error. But through it all, this hodgepodge of people that don't seem like they can go together, and they unite with a single purpose, a solid foundation, coming together under the same Spirit, we see those glimpses of God's kingdom, brilliant and beautiful. Will you pray with me? O Lord, our God, we come together today. We come together united under one Spirit, building a community with one single foundation. God, we pray that as we lay bricks upon our foundations, whatever those bricks may be, from family to friends to school to work to our nation, that each and every building block will carry the footprints of the foundation, the footprints of Christ. God, in the power of your Holy Spirit, may we build a community that may seem as folly to those on the outside, but one that you see as wise, brilliant, and beautiful. All this we pray in Christ's holy name. Amen. Our hope is built on Christ our Lord. Let us stand and sing and celebrate our foundation. As we prepare to go back out into the world, let us do so know that we are walking together on a single foundation, foundation of Christ built by the power of the Holy Spirit. And may in all we do and in all we say and in all the ways we live, seek to build a community that mirrors the kingdom of God in this world. Go now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.